In this video, we'll start using op amps in actual circuits. In particular, we'll take a look at the inverting amplifier configuration. In the last video, we saw what the virtual ground concept is and what happens to an op amp when it is in feedback. We need the op amp to be in negative feedback, so that we can amplify signals without the output saturating. In this video, we'll actually start building circuits. Let's take an op amp and connect it in negative feedback. We saw that the simplest way of doing this is by using a resistor divider in the feedback loop. We want to give some input to this op amp. For that, we have three options. We can give the input to the inverting terminal, or the non-inverting terminal, or both. Let's start off with giving an input to the inverting terminal only. Suppose we give an input Vin to the inverting terminal side. Our objective is to find a relation between Vout and Vin. Let the voltage at the inverting input of the op amp be Vx. Say a current I1 flows from the input source through the resistor R1 towards Vx, and a current I2 flows from Vx through the resistor R2 towards the output node Vout. Since the op amp is ideal, no current flows through the input terminals. Hence, this current I1 has only one path to follow. That is through R2, towards the output node. To find the value of this current, we can write a Kirchhoff's current law at node Vx. The current flowing through R1 is Vin minus Vx upon R1, by Ohm's law. This current is the same as I2, which will be Vx minus Vout upon R2. Equating these two, this is the equation we get. Take a look at this equation. We know Vin, we want to find Vout, but there is one unknown, Vx. How can we find the value of Vx? Well, that's pretty simple. This op amp is in negative feedback, which means the virtual ground concept holds. So, the non-inverting and inverting inputs are at the same potential. As the non-inverting input is grounded, it's at a zero potential. Hence, the inverting input must also be at zero potential. That means the value of Vx is simply zero. So, our equation simply reduces to Vin upon R1, is equal to minus Vout upon R2. Rearranging the terms, we get Vout upon Vin as minus R2 upon R1. And our job is done. We've created an amplifier, whose gain is minus R2 upon R1. Just by changing the values of R2 and R1, we can control the gain of the op amp. The negative sign here indicates that the output is 180 degrees out of phase with the input, or simply put, inverted. Hence, this configuration is called an inverting amplifier. So, suppose we have an inverting amplifier with R2 equal to 2 kilo ohms and R1 equal to 1 kilo ohm. Then, the magnitude of gain of the op amp will be 2. If we feed a sinusoidal input to this circuit, we will get an inverted sinusoid at the output with twice the amplitude. In this way, we achieve amplification using an op amp. You might be thinking, what will happen in the case of a practical op amp? In the end, that's what we'll use in real life. Let's take a practical op amp, with an open loop gain A, in the exact same configuration as before. We note that the currents flowing through R1 and R2 are given by Vin minus Vx upon R1, and Vx minus Vout by R2, respectively. Moreover, by the basic amplifying action of the op amp, Vout will be the open loop gain A into the differential input voltage, which is simply 0 minus Vx. So the output will be minus A Vx, or Vx is minus Vout by A. When dealing with op amp non-idealities, we consider one non-ideality at a time. So, for instance, in this case the gain of the op amp is finite, we consider the input resistance of the op amp to be infinite and output resistance to be zero, just like an ideal op amp. Hence, the currents in R1 and R2 will be the same, as no current can flow through the inputs of the op amp. Equating the currents in R1 and R2, and substituting Vx equal to minus V out by A, we get the following equation. A little simplification gives us this, which is the equation of the gain of an inverting amplifier with finite op amp gain. Look closely at this equation. If the open loop gain A is very large in magnitude, the second term in the denominator tends towards zero, and hence can be neglected. This will leave us with just minus R2 upon R1, which is the gain of an inverting amplifier with an ideal op amp. Hence, for sufficiently high values of op amp gain, we can just assume the op amp to be ideal and solve the circuit. That's all about the inverting amplifier. In the next video, we'll see what a non-inverting amplifier is, so stay tuned. If you have any doubts, please ask in the comments section. Don't forget to like, share, and subscribe.